Hey, what's up, everybody? Thanks for tuning in to another episode of Let There Be Talk. Today is a handmade edition, fantastic, and it's brought to you by my great sponsor, El Cajon Harley. El Cajon Harley Davidson, located in Southern California, your number one motorcycle dealer. Do not get your motorcycle anywhere else. Go down to El Cajon Harley, see my boy Greg Riley, and get yourself on a brand new 2017 Harley. Maybe get a touring bike and head out to Sturgis and just blow off life. Say, fuck it, I'm riding motorcycles for the rest of my life. That's what you got to do. Quit your job and go ride across America. Who cares, right? El Cajon Harley can help you with that dream. Go see them. They can get you financing. And then don't pay on the financing. Fuck it. Get that bike repoed later. At least you lived it, right?
Don't fucking talk about it. Shit.
All right.
Go see him right now.
Great guest right now. Introduce yourself.
Hey, I'm Gabriel Currie. I own Echopark Guitars in Los Angeles, but now going to Detroit.
Yeah, man. Now, you know, I heard about your guitars from numerous people, Steve Rose, of course, and but one of my favorite humans on the planet, Dave Catching, plays the Carina V,
yeah.
And I am an absolute Carina V freak, and I saw it, and I was like, oh, I want one of those, you know?
Right.
And,
me too.
Yeah, right? It's hilarious. And so I started jumping down the rabbit hole, and I realized you were right here in Echo Park. And by the time I hit you up to do the podcast, you were driving down the freeway on your way to Detroit with the shop completely packed up. Yeah. So let's get into that a little bit.
Yeah, I, you know, born and raised here in Los Angeles. And
wow, where at?
Actually, Highland Park and East LA, you know, greater East LA, just Glass Hill Park, Highland Park predominantly. Gang-infested neighborhoods of the 70s and that kind of thing.
Highland Park has changed, huh?
It's insane, yeah.
I mean, how old are you?
I'll be 50 in a year.
Yeah, I'm 51, yeah. So when you were growing up there, yeah. It was straight up just ghetto, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it was a complete shithole. I mean, it was super cools, heroin, trains, you know? The fucking trains were all, there was a railroad. Not a station, but like a, I don't even know what you would call it. It was like the crossroads where all the trains converged, like behind Dodger Stadium, that whole area going
right.
Along like the river and shit, you know. It was just like clank and clunk all day, all night, and just, you know, people fighting and getting shot and fucking chicks screaming.
Old school LA.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, even, you know, we look at Echo Park. I mean, I remember 15 years ago or whatever, seeing a movie called Echo Park. I think it was, wait, was it Echo Park? Yeah, about the girl gangs, you yeah. know? Mm-hmm. And I was like, wow, I mean, it has so changed, you know? And it's creeped because what happens is West Hollywood's too much money. So then people moved to, you know, the first neighborhood to really blow up was Silver Lake.
Yeah, my dad was an artist, and so he taught at Barnsdale Park when I was a kid, and, you know, gave lessons and bullshit like that. And then I first started going into Echo Park proper about 10 years old.
Right.
You know, I was about 10 years old, and it always seemed like another, you know, another ghetto, obviously, but it seemed a little different. I never knew the history of it growing up until maybe 20 years ago.
What is the history of that? They got the beautiful lake there.
It's the birthplace of the film industry, basically.
The film industry?
As we know it. Yeah, the first film, the Max Sennett Studios, was erected there on Glendale Avenue, right before you hit the Echo Park sign as you're going into Echo Park off the 2 freeway on Glendale Avenue.
Yeah.
All that was actually basically the Hollywood film studios from back in the day. Laurel and Hardy, all the Keystone Cops, all that shit.
Wow.
Came out of the Keystone Studios and then the Max Sennett, and then Keystone Studios was erected about maybe 5 years later right across the street. So, you know, the birthplace of the film industry and actually the entertainment industry as we know it, you know, kind of started there. And when I started kind of getting the itch to get back into you know, making guitars again, because I left guitar making when I was in my late 20s because I wanted to go fuck and do drugs and tour and record.
Were you playing music at the time? Let's get into a little bit of the history of that. Like, so you're young growing up in L.A., and you're 50 now, so what are you into back then? Are you into the punk scene? Are you into the glam, the, you know, hair scene? Are you into Jane's Addiction? What are you listening to?
I was listening to Muddy Waters and Howlin' Wolf.
Oh, wow, you're a blues guy.
Yeah, I was listening to all that stuff, and I got into guitar building as... I couldn't keep up with the Shred guys and the Van Halen thing and the whole trip, you know, during the 80s. It wasn't my thing. I was, you know, like I said, you know, Clapton, Howlin' Wolf, B.B. King, Elmore James.
Stevie Ray.
Stevie. Well, that was a little later, but yeah, as a kid, of course, I mean, he was there, and it was like, okay, then you get turned on to, like, all the Kings and all that shit. And so I got steeped in, you know, American music, really, like, you know, and then country, of course. And then I was also into AC/DC, and then I heard Fear, the record.
Who?
Fear.
A Fear. And then, oh, my God, and the first one.
Yeah, and my friend Tony Malone, who's still my friend today, he was in a band called Detox back then.
Yeah.
It was a seminal L.A. punk rock band. They were out of Highland Park, and right next door to them, Exene and those guys lived there. You know, John and Exene lived right next door to them. So at, you know, 11, 12... I got introduced to punk rock.
Wow.
And that was when...
And that's the ground zero shit. Yeah. X, Fear, yeah. Circle Jerks, mm-hmm. You know, all Black that Flag stuff. And, yeah, Black Flag,
guys, you know,
Germs.
Germs, yeah, ironically, yeah, all that stuff.
Dead Kennedys, rocking them, San Fran stuff.
Everything, yeah, Flipper, all that stuff.
Yeah, so, Flipper.
So I was, you know, Agent Orange... you know,
yeah,
everything, you know. So I got into all that stuff.
You going to shows back then, like at the Palladium? Yeah. Well, where are you going?
We were going to the Stardust Ballroom a lot.
Oh, sick.
Yeah, Stardust Ballroom a lot. Raji's, of course, Al's Bar, you know, the Gaslight, that was still there.
Gas Lamp?
Fender's Ballroom.
Oh, yeah, Fender's Ballroom.
You know, the Doll Hut, you know, later
the
on.
The Doll Hut, I forgot about that. Orange County.
Yeah, all that stuff.
Wow.
The Scream.
The Scream.
All those clubs. And so I was you know, a young kid, you know, wasted youth, all that shit. So.
Who were some of your favorites you saw back then? Because I saw X not until they got back together finally when they get, you know, Billy Zoom back in the band. Yeah. I remember this was probably, you know, late 90s or something. They played the Guinness Beer Festival, and it fucking blew my mind, man. I mean, I couldn't believe Billy Zoom, the way he played and that weird winking and his moves and shit, and then those two harmonies going, you know, like when they cover Soul Kitchen and shit.
Yeah, well, his dad, you know, Billy's dad was a big band guy, jazz guy, so he grew up in a very musical house, and I think he plays several other instruments. He is like a fucking genius. That guy's like a total rocket science.
Yeah, he's like an idiot savant, right? He builds stuff. Completely. He builds his own amps and shit.
Everything. And so when I first heard X and got in, it was a Fear, X, Detox, and Black Flag were kind of the things that I circled around. And you know, those, you know, Circle Jerks and all those other guys. But those were the ones that I was like latching onto. And it was kind of more because of the roots of like the vocals and the melodies and stuff like that were still very much rooted in blues and stuff like that.
Yeah, and they had songs.
Yeah,
and you know, it's funny melodies. Because when you listen to like Holiday in Cambodia, you know what I mean? That's a goddamn hit.
Yeah.
You know, the first time I heard it, I was like, oh, who's that? Yeah. I heard it on KUSF, Howie Klein played it, you know, and it's like, here it is, Holiday in Cambodia. And I was like, man, that song is amazing. I didn't even know what the fuck it was, you know?
Jellyby is a genius to this day.
And yeah.
He still like represents a... The thing about punk rock to me was like it represented all the fucking degenerates, you know, and all the losers and fucking, you know, and we weren't even like officially losers or anything.
A lot like heavy metal, you know, just different kinds of heavy metal is kind of blue collar kids who, you know, parents, a divorce hits big time in the 70s and 80s and they're just like angst and shit. Yeah. Same with that.
Yeah. Yeah. A lot of... a lot of misdirected energy and you know, youth. I mean, the thing that we all kind of go through. So, and you know, my parents were together and stuff like that, but they're kind of a mixed couple, if you will. My mom was Native American and my dad, white as the driven snow.
Right.
And so there was a culture class of sorts there, but I guess they had great sex. So that's day was four. Something was good, right?
Yeah. It's funny. If I close my eyes, I would think I'm interviewing Sean Penn. You sound a lot like him and you kind of look like him, you know?
Fuck, give me his money. I'll take 10% of his fucking down.
So early on, you decide you want to build guitars.
I don't know if I decided. I think it was just one of those things where I was naturally curious and wanted to take shit apart and figure out how it worked. And guitars just kind of, the allure was like this magical thing that makes, you know, women go crazy and people dance and Elvis and, you know, all this, you know, Chuck Berry and all that stuff. It's like the people are, you know, it's kind of like the Pied Piper kind of, it's like a lute, you know? And so I just was attracted to the mechanical aspect of it, you know, and how and why it did that thing that it does. And still to this day, I don't know what that is.
Right. Were you in high school taking wood shop and metal shop and shit like that?
I took wood shop in the seventh grade and started making like big giant pipes to smoke weed out of and shit like that.
Yeah, you know,
First thing on the list, you know.
You doing a lot of drugs back then?
Yeah.
Yeah. What were you into?
I was into speed and pot.
That was the drug, right? Speed.
Crosstops.
That gets you working on guitars. You're tweaking, you start tearing shit apart, right?
Yeah, crosstops, weed, and alcohol. And then as I graduated into the punk rock scene and started hanging out with a bunch of dirtbags and street, you know, urchins, it was heroin.
Yeah.
I got into heroin and crystal meth and all that good shit. And you know, I think it's how you do things like that, not necessarily that you do them or not. You know, it's kind of, if you're lucky enough to kind of have an internal buffer that, you know, kind of keeps you close enough to the edge, but not going over, it's
all
good. And I don't know that, I think as I progressed in that, it kind of all just went hand in hand. You know, it's like drugs, guitars, pussy, and music. You know, it was just like a culture of that, you know, and living in abandoned houses and, you know, all that good shit. So
it's funny because I remember that big Say No to Drugs whole campaign in the 80s and all that Nancy Reagan shit and stuff. And I would never take back all the partying that I did, because it's what you learn from it. You learn a few things, endurance. You learn about your body. And then you can really, like you said, you go all the way to the edge, but don't go over. And then you come back with the notes. You know what I mean? Like, here's what I learned from that, like, weird bender.
Yeah, like, I stayed up with Steve Heumann from the Vandals for, like, I think 2 weeks, and I was, like, 16.
Yeah.
You know, and what we did in those 2 weeks, I can't really recall what it is, but I know we had a great adventure, because we went up and down the coast in this little, I think it was a fastback, and...
Yeah.
And, you know, he gave me the 2 week tour of like, this is how you do it kind of thing. And he's still alive today. And we're still friends. And,
some Jack Kerouac shit there, right there.
Yeah.
Right?
Like right off the bat, like as a kid, it's like, here's a bag of speed and this is how you shoot it.
Yeah.
You know, and there was no like, and this is like, you know, 85.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So 84, maybe, I don't know, something like that. And dangerous times, but we didn't really give a shit. We didn't think about anything like that.
Yeah. Well, you're not thinking about, you know, the future. You're just like, I mean, I seriously never thought I'd live to be 51.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Right.
You're just like, you're on the planet and your idols are burning it up and you're burning it up right next to them.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I knew as a kid, like, you know, Hendrix and Page were, you know, dabbling and stuff. I didn't know what exactly they were doing, but I know they were on some shit. So, I mean, later on, I learned that they were.
And all the blues guys.
All those cats. All the jazz cats, too. All the heavy jazz cats. So, I mean, from Jaco Pastorius, you know, down to Coltrane, all those guys were all fucking junkies. So when I got into dope, It was through a guy in Venice Beach. He was Ricardo Hernandez. He was an artist. And we'd just been hanging out. And I think I was 17. And we went downtown together, and he was going down there to score, and I was just hanging out with him, you know. We got back to his studio back in Venice, and he did me up the first time. And
wow.
And that was it, you know. It was kind of, you know, immediately I was immersed in the drug culture, like 100% then. So, and I was still working on guitars, and all those guys, those guitars I was fucking with. And then, you know, Ted Falcone, actually, I spent some time with him, tweaking fucking balls,
yeah,
and working on guitars and amps and shit. And so that's kind of all I've ever really done.
Yeah, yeah. How'd you learn, like, when you first, what are you doing? You're just repairing guitars at first, so you're getting into like changing pickups, knobs, yeah, and capacitors, yeah, like the kids, all that shit.
Yeah, all the shred dudes in junior high school, you know, that had way more faculty than I could muster at the time to do all that technical shit. All wanted, you know, Floyd Roses and the DiMarzios and the pickups and the this and that. So I was just kind of in a particular, you know, in a position where I could, you know, figure it out, basically.
Yeah.
So I actually would ditch school a lot and go to these other guitar repair guys in the neighborhoods and just go hang out there all day and just watch them and learn,
right,
and kind of go back to school the next day or the next couple of days later and go, hey, I can, you know, I can give me, yeah, your shit, I'll hook it up, you know.
Wow. And you're like an early tattooist.
Yeah.
Carving into some guy's Charvel,
yeah,
put a Kaler on there.
Yeah,
or,
yeah.
Everybody, that was the era where everybody needed a Kaler or Floyd Rose or EMG 81 pickups.
Yeah, and we
you
all
know?
Had shitty guitars. We all had, like, you know, shitty Japanese guitars or, you know, just like, there wasn't even like Mexican strats then. It was all just.
Well, also back then, guitars were cheap.
Oh.
You know what I mean? It's like you could get a Charvel for like $500, yeah, you know? Or and Les Pauls were a dime a dozen,
oh,
you know?
It was mostly SGs and Telecasters and,
yeah,
and strats. I mean, I was in juniors, you know? I can't tell you. I'd be bummed out, actually, if I could remember all the great guitars that I fucked up, you know, like, yeah, altering them for friends of mine that wanted to fucking have a Floyd Rose or something.
A Floyd Rose on an SG,
yeah,
Junior, just, can you imagine?
Oh, no, I've done it. So, you know, I'm guilty as fuck of ruining a bunch of shit, but, yeah, I didn't know. It was just an opportunity to me, and those things were a fucking dime a dozen back then.
Yeah, totally.
You know, I mean, uncles were giving that shit away. So.
They weren't collector's guitars. I remember I was talking to Albert at Guitars R Us, and he had a million 59s and 58s.
Yeah.
Not a million, but he had one of the biggest collections, like 30 or something, and he got them all from guys coming in going, this is my uncle's piece of shit, Les, yeah, Paul. I want that Charvel or, yeah, that Jackson up,
yeah,
there on the wall. And,
yeah,
he'd go, here you go, trade.
Yeah.
And now, look, he's retired out in Malibu with the most expensive guitars in the world.
Yeah, who would have known? I mean, I always liked them just because the blues guys had them. You know, I got hit to juniors because Leslie West was playing them and,
yeah,
stuff like that. So that's where I was really like, oh, that's the sound, you know, that I want. And, okay, a Sun amp and a junior. That's what I'm going to... So that's what I adopted, you know. And that was... It's always been my thing was like Tellys and juniors and all that kind of stuff.
I think the Blackguard Telly... And I had this discussion with Mark Agnese from Norms.
Mm-hmm.
And all these years, I worshipped the 59 and the Telly, you know. But at the end of the day, I think the Blackguard Esquire, the 50, 51, 52, 53 Esquire is the best guitar ever made.
Yeah, I mean,
as far as like just a blue collar rock and roll machine.
Yeah, I mean, you can cover so much ground on that instrument. I mean, with the right amp, you can really do a lot of, I mean, as exemplified by Jimmy Page on the first Led Zeppelin album. I,
yeah,
mean, that's what that is. You know, it's a Supro and a Telly.
Yeah,
know?
Yeah, it's a slab board, like, Telly. Yeah,
and you, I mean, and if you start listening to a bunch of stuff, you can hear that everywhere on a bunch of stuff. And, you know, nobody was really... The rules hadn't been established yet. You know, there was no doctrine. There was no... You know what I mean? Everybody was still kind of figuring it out, and so a lot of the silver tones and shitty little amps that you hear on like blues records and stuff like that. Those are the things that got ingrained into my DNA, into my sonic DNA, because it's all I was listening to, you know. So when I got mature enough to kind of develop a thing, you know, to start developing a voice, and then develop my the way I build, you know, it took a minute, because I had to kind of go back to that, you know, and kind of allow that to surface, because I worked for Leo Fender right out of high school.
You did?
Yeah.
Out there in Fullerton?
Yeah, at the G&L plant.
Wow. What year was that?
That was 1988.
88. Yeah. And what are you doing out there? Are you just building guitars?
I actually got hired on to just be a helper in the wood shop, you know, just pick up scraps and clean up and shit like that. Within a couple of weeks, I was basically running the shop.
Wow.
I just had a really keen, I had, you know.
And this is pre-Master Builders and pre-Relics. Like, Fender, to me, doesn't really come back alive until they first build that No-Caster Relic, the first one. They do the No-Caster Relic, and all of a sudden, you know, people are like, whoa, this is a fucking Fender. It's got cloth wiring. It's got nitrocellulose paint. It's got the Bakelite guard, you know?
Yeah, there was a guy named Vincent... I forget his last name, but there's a guy named Vincent who did those first, you know, those first custom shop ones. But prior to that, this is like 1988, I got hired by Leo, George Fullerton, and Floyd. And those were the original guard.
You know,
back in the 52.
You talking to Leo and stuff?
Yeah, I mean, he was a little, you know, he was fucked up because he had a couple of strokes and shit like that. But he was kind of mumbling and murmuring, you know, kind of thing. But I got him alone after the interview, and I brought a guitar that I built. And he's like, you know, he asked me a couple questions about it, and we had a little conversation back and forth, and he just kind of looked at me, and he shook his, you know, we shook hands, and he like had a fierce grip.
Wow.
And we shook hands for like a like awkward, like hard fucking handshake.
Yeah. I always say that the old days, you know, good grip, and then you just fucking held it, and that's how you knew you were a man or not. How weird is that?
Yeah, it was great.
Remember the old, this guy's got a soft shake. Let's get the fuck out of here. Soft shake is such a weird thing.
Yeah, so we did the grip thing, and I got hired. The next day it started, and it was like I immediately knew. Well, this guy that was working there at the time, his name was Ed Seabest, and I think he was in the, I want to say that he was in the Heartbreakers or something, like one of those seminal bands back in New York back in the day.
The old punk rock Heartbreakers?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
And one of those bands. It was either the Cheetahs or the Heartbreakers or one of those things. And he was running the neck department. So we got to talking and knew some of the same cats from the scene. And so it was him and I running the fucking wood shop, building custom guitars for like Will Ray and those guys in the Hellcasters and the old guard coming from Bakersfield still. You know, and all that shit, because they were like country.
Yeah, that Bakersfield guitar. Whole fucking thing.
G&L was all country guitars and shit like that. They weren't really a rock and roll guitar company.
G&L. Oh, yeah, G&L.
Yeah.
You know, I talk about them all the time. The first year the G&L came out, you know, that was Leo's dream to have an upper class, you know, high end Strat and Tele.
Yeah.
And that candy apple red G&L that came out, it had that crazy, it wasn't a Floyd Rose or anything. It was their own tremolo.
The fulcrum tremolo.
And it had those switches to split coils and shit. Mm-hmm. That fucking guitar was killer, man.
I think it was a Comanche or an SC1. And there was a couple of other ones. But right when I got hired there, I was like, okay, now I'm fucking in the shit. So, and Ed and I would talk about it every day, how lucky we were to be working under that. Like, we knew that it was special. Like, we knew this was the last vestige of Leo.
Of the old guard,
Leo and the old guard. And so Floyd died first, and then Leo died, and then a couple of years later, you know, George Fullerton died. And I was able to kind of be there during that time and soak up some of that DNA. And that really was that's kind of where I learned production and like numbers and how to really like, you know, mill everything and glue it all up a certain way and what glue to use and thicknesses and pin routers and just all the manufacturing processes. And he was still doing, it was all 50 style production. It wasn't
high glue and all that shit.
No, we were using aliphatic, you know, yellow wood glue, basically nothing special, but like the conditions, the environment here in Southern California has been pretty stable up until like the end of the 90s, I think. I haven't done any measuring, but then it was all stable, so you could get stuff right off the truck, glue it up, have it in the clamps, and route it the next fucking day and send it on down the line.
Oh, because of the weather and everything.
Yeah. Now we've had like 5 years of fucking endless summer and drought and shit, and just the climate's just changed completely. You can't, stuff that I've had for, wood that I've had for 20 years, pristine, cured, dried, quarter sawn, beautiful wood, started splitting on me a couple of years ago.
Wow.
Yeah.
Because it's drying out weird?
Because it's dry and hot. You know, hot as fuck and dry. And that's kind of what got me thinking about skipping town, basically.
It was the climate change.
Yeah, that.
But Trump says there's no climate change. So,
well,
yeah. Anyway, I get it though. I mean, it is. You know, up until this year, I told people that, like, you know, back in the day when I first moved to LA, let's say 16 years ago, in August to September, it would be like 90s, upper 90s, and you'd be like, "This is fucking crazy," but. You know, the last 5 years, it's like 85 to 95 for 6-7 months. Yeah. You're like, how fucking hot is it here? Yeah. You know? And then everybody's blazing the AC and the fucking...
Yeah, it's bacon and there's fucking 30 Brazilian people here and all nationalities, all walks of life.
Yeah.
All different, you know, ethnicities and economic backgrounds, of course. It's a huge metropolis, but... The LA that I grew up in and remember is probably just as shitty as it is now, except I was a kid and didn't have a child or a wife, didn't have any thought
bills.
Of buying a house. Or
you didn't have to pay car registration where it's fucking, $1,000 a year.
Yeah, none of that
over
shit.
And over, you know?
Yeah, none of that shit existed. So by the time I grew up, which is only a couple of years ago, really, but... By the time I grew up, I quit making guitars when I was 28.
Why'd you quit?
Because I didn't want to wind up at the NAMM show floor, which is the National Association of Musical Merchants. It's a huge convention.
Talk about it all the time.
That goes on every year.
Anaheim Convention Center.
Yeah, all the music guys converge, and it's, you know, all the world sellers and dealers and wheelers and dealers and all that shit. And I just saw myself, I was so in love with what I was doing after I left. After Leo died, I went to work for a guy named Taco Sono. And he was a hand builder, taught me all the handcrafted part of making guitars.
What was his company called?
Hosono Guitar Works. And he built he was strictly handmade guitars, mail order, one of the first mail order custom guitar guys in the world.
Wow.
And he was out of here. It was at the time of like Valley Arts and, you know.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And Michael Tobias. And so there was a really great, heavy, like custom guitar culture here in the city. And so I got hooked up with him and immediately learned the other side of
the art of it.
The art of guitar making and instrument building and wood selection and combining different pickup configurations and different scale lengths and hand shaping necks and, you know, all the, there's goes on and on and on. But I immersed myself in that for a few years. And by the time I started thinking about like what my future would be like, I was in a band. I was, you know, still doing a lot of drugs, but somehow I managed to, I kind of got sick of it, actually. It was just way too, like, I found myself wanting to get behind the wheel more. You know, I found myself
actually play the fucking
wanting
things.
To, like, discover what the fuck these things actually did and why, and get deeper into like vintage guitars and old guitars and figuring out what it was that was so special about them versus a Charvel.
Yeah.
Or anything new, basically.
Yeah, an Ibanez.
Any of that shit. Because they just were totally different things, and they felt different, they smelled different.
Yep.
You know, everything about them was different. So I wanted to kind of get back to that. So, and I wanted to play and fuck and do drugs and tour and, you know, whatever else.
Yep.
And so it was just the responsibility part of showing up to a fucking job every day and working with machines that could take your fucking hand off in a second started becoming not that important to me. You know, I started to think, well, I've done this now for about 10 years. You know, I think I want to go do something else for a while. And I didn't want to wind up at the fucking NAMM show with the name tag on the shirt and waving and
yeah,
selling somebody else's shit. You know,
I tell you what, man, I go to the NAMM show. You know, I went the last 5 years, but I hadn't gone for like 20 years. And the NAMM show, there's some sad, I can feel weird, sad vibes when I'm in places, and it might sound corny or whatever, but I can feel spiritual, weird, bad shit and stuff. And I remember seeing a guy, there's guys that are just standing at their booth that they spent like $5,800 worth. Oh. They traveled from, like, you know, say Spokane, Washington. Yeah. They set their booth up and they got their stuff and they just stand there and people just fucking walk on by them all day long. Yeah, and I feel horrible for them because they you know, they don't have that money. They're like, fuck it, I'll go to NAMM. Maybe I'll pick up some kind of, you know, distribution deal or something. Yeah. And it's really sad and scary, man.
Yeah, it's horrible. And like, having done a lot of acid shit like that as a kid, I was like, okay, that's like the fucking worst acid trip I could ever do. Like, what you said. Like,
just,
and so I envisioned that as you know, 27, 28. And I was like, okay, I'm not doing that. That's just not my reality. I can't do that. I'd rather go do everything else. And if the universe permits, and I still have hands and able-minded and still into this shit, I'll come back to this later.
So you actually had that vision.
I had that conversation with myself in the mirror one day, and I called my boss and said, hey, I quit. And I left him in a horrible lurch, because at the time he had just a huge production run of Ibanez USA custom shit that we were doing for like Steve Vai or something like that.
Like the floral guitars and shit like that?
No, it was prior to the Monkey Grip ones. It was the neck through, the first USA custom ones.
The first gems and shit?
Ibanez did, before the gems.
Wow.
Yeah,
this
was USA custom line, and it was, I forget what the model was, but
so Ibanez was parting out their custom shop stuff to you guys.
Yeah,
that's fucking incredible.
Yeah,
so that's some good made shit, you know.
Oh yeah, no, we did Michael Tobias's stuff. We did Roger Sadowski's basses.
Wow,
we did a bunch of high end, you know, so called builders. We were ghost building for them, basically, and doing custom mail order stuff, and you know, guys like Zappa and. Yeah, I did some stuff for Frank and his kid, and then
you did some stuff for Frank
Lukather and, you know, guys like that.
Steve Lukather, what did you do for Frank? He had that one SG forever, right?
We worked on a couple of his old guitars, and then he was always like fucking with new shit. So a couple of weird strats and stuff like that. I think that Naples strat that he had for a while.
Wow.
So just stuff like that. So through
did you ever talk to Frank?
No, I never talked to any of those guys. I was the guy in the back. Nobody knew that I was there. You know?
You're like back there just fucking sniffing solder.
I was the assistant. So, you know, and having had that experience and being close to it, you know, I thought, well, fuck, you know, this guy is Japanese, first of all. I'm American. I should be the one fucking making these things, not this guy. Yeah. So there was a lot of, you know, when you're young, it's easy to kind of get
bitter.
Yeah, resentful. You know, as you're going along your thing, and you're seeing the chinks in the armor of others, you know, and you're developing your thing. So that's when I just quit. I was like, fuck it, I'm not doing this no more. I can't. You know, I'm not gonna be that fucking bald dude in fucking NAMM. You know, at 40 years old. working for some other fucking quack, you know, I'm just not going to do it. I'd rather flip the fucking coin in the air and go stick my dick in a bunch of shit and fucking shove needles in my arms and go get behind the wheel and play.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, so, I get behind that, man. I get it, man. It's yeah, just so like, let's fucking gamble on my own self.
Yeah, so that's what I did. I wanted to really, like, you know, really figure it out, you know, and see, like, test myself, you know, and see how willing I was to go all the way back down the rabbit hole and come back up again. So that's what I did for a while, and it led me to some places that I didn't really plan on going, but, you know, I got there, and I got out of there, too. So
did you go to jail?
I went to prison a couple of times.
Wow. Yeah. And what'd you go for, robbery and stuff?
Armed robbery, the first one. Yeah.
Wow. And how did that go down? You rob a liquor store or what? Because I always trip on armed robbery, you know, because you're basically addicted to drugs, right? And you're like, I got a fucking score, and car stereos ain't paying for it, right?
Yeah, I don't think I was really that addicted to drugs. I think the people that I was hanging out with at the time were still, like, shitty people, basically, and I kind of lived this dual life, you know. Up until I had my kid, I lived like I always had like the shittiest, seediest, like, friends, like criminals and dope fiends, and then I had like my family and like all my nice friends and shit, you know.
It's almost like a Bukowski thing, like you're this writer but you gotta go fucking way dark to write, you know.
You gotta go deep, man. And like my dad was an artist, so I coming up, and we lived in the fucking ghetto, so I always had that weird dichotomy of like looking out the window and seeing fucking drunks and fuckers like either fucking the alley or fighting or whatever, or shooting each other, and then my dad would be locked away in the back room doing a fucking oil painting. Or
the juxtapose of that is crazy.
A watercolor of fucking flowers and trees and shit.
That was his getaway. Yeah, man, that for was sure. His he was like, I ain't looking out that window. Yeah. I gotta paint my own happy piece here.
Yeah, and he never sat me down and said, son, this is how you do it. Right? Yeah. Stuck a brush in my hand or any of that shit. I just kind of saw it. I witnessed it, you know, so it became a part of how I lived.
You robbed the liquor store?
No, I robbed a Coke dealer.
A Coke dealer?
A huge black Coke dealer and his gay lover.
Wow.
Yeah, it was awesome.
And it was a place where you're scoring drugs all the time?
No, actually a friend of mine who's a drug dealer, we had his kids staying with me and my girlfriend at the time in Inglewood, and I was working. And his kid came home one day, and he was young, like 13, 14. We were taking him to school. We were watching him because his dad was busted, basically.
Right.
And so, and he came home one day and said this dude had been following him home for the last couple of days to our house. And this last time he had stopped and basically hit him up, you know, like, hey, kid, I want to fuck you, kind of thing. And so I called a couple of buddies that I knew, and I had him. He did the same thing the following day, and we followed the guy to his fucking house, and it just turned out that he was a coke dealer. It wasn't like we knew he was a coke dealer. We were actually going there to fuck him up, basically.
Right.
And when we got in the house. This is horrible. Yeah. I've already been arrested for this.
Yeah,
thing,
yeah,
so
yeah,
already,
yeah. Yeah, you're great now.
So I'm not incriminating myself.
Yeah.
We basically... I had a .38 special, a police special. My friend had a .45, and we went in. We didn't kick the door down or anything like that. It was about 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock in the evening. We had the kid go to the house with the guy. We followed him there. They were in the bedroom, and he was getting ready to, you know, start fondling him or whatever. And we got in the house. As soon as we got in the house, we realized where we were.
Yeah.
Because we saw a couple of briefcases, a couple of bags, a couple of stacks of dough.
Wow.
So we got all that shit in the bag first.
Yeah.
And then we kicked the door in on the bedroom.
Yeah.
And the dude was undressed. The kid was still dressed, just in terror. And we duct taped the dude. And then we went into the other room, and his lover was in there, and we duct taped him, gagged him, put him face down on the bed, went back into the other room to the big guy, did the same thing to him. And then we started ransacking the place looking for the rest of the shit.
Yeah. Wow. This is fucking crazy shit. Yeah.
So we started going through the place, collecting goods, and we were just about done, and we left the guy alone in the room, and he got loose out of the duct tape that we had duct taped him with, and he had a piece underneath the pillow, and we didn't, you know, we're fucking kids, we didn't know that. And,
yeah.
You know, we're like 19, 20, something like that. And he came popping out of that thing, firing.
Whoa!
And my buddy split. He got out of there, and I was left there. And so he actually got one off on me without because I wasn't on my guard.
Yeah.
And
he shot you?
Yeah, I got.
Where
shot.
At?
I got actually. It was actually almost point blank range. And I was enough to get my arms up in front of me.
Yeah.
With the loaded gun in one hand, and he got me through the wrist here.
Whoa, yeah, I could see it. Right. Oh, it went through both arms.
And out here,
it exited. Holy shit.
So I was shot. So he took off after my friend, and I took off down the street. And
what a scene.
Yeah, it was crazy.
And so how do you get arrested for that? Because who's calling the cops on that? He's a dealer.
Yeah, he called the cops. Maybe he didn't. Maybe it was one of the neighbors or something like that, because it was shots fired in the neighborhood, you know. I mean, it's Inglewood, but still, you know. So I get arrested, and I get, you know, I didn't, you know, I wasn't going to say anything, of course, but, you know, so I got a 5-year sentence. And I did 2.5 years on that.
Wow. Where were you out?
I was actually out in Chino, and then I went up to Soledad.
Wow.
From there. So I was just fresh fucking, you know.
That's got to be fucking just a complete game changer, right?
I mean, I didn't really plan on going down that road, but yeah, it changed me forever, you know.
Yep.
Nothing bad. You know, I didn't get raped or any of that shit, and I didn't have to, you know, do anything stupid, but... I immediately there was guitars in there.
Oh wow!
So I immediately went to, it's called Arts and Corrections. So they'll, like, you can check out guitars when you get to prison, or at least back then you could. There was you know, art education type stuff. So after the reception center and like 6 months of getting to where you're gonna go do your time, I finally got there, and then there was a room with fucking guitars and old Gretches and amps and shit, and it was,
wow,
like, oh, this is cool. So immediately I started doing that, you know, and there was a wood shop there, so I made another guitar there and just kind of furthered my passion, you know. Just kind of, you know, I look back on it and go, wow, I guess I was kind of undeterred, you know. I didn't get into any of the goofiness. I didn't make me into a better criminal or any of that shit. I wasn't interested in learning more about the trade. I said, okay, well, that was stupid, and well, you know, I'll learn my lesson here. So I got out, and a couple of years later, and continued making guitars again. So
wow, yes. I mean, also, if you look at it, it's like you get out and you're like, you know, you're like, fuck, what am I going to do with my life, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, because that's like 2 years or whatever go by, and you're like, I better do something, right?
Yeah, so I got out, and it was 92, something like that. Leo was dead. That was when I got into the next phase, and I had started my own thing. So maybe 93, actually.
Where do you land when you get out? Are you in Echo Park?
I'm in Los Angeles. I'm in Highland Park, back home.
Highland Park, got it.
Yeah, wound up going back home, and then just started picking up the pieces again. And at that point, I went back to work for a classical guitar maker for a little while, and then back to work making guitars for TAC. And that lasted a little while, and then I moved down to San Diego and hooked up with a guy named Scott. Scott Madison.
Yeah.
And he was making guitars for the guys in the Scorpions. And
in the what?
In the Scorpions.
Oh, the Scorpions.
He was doing like knockoffs of Carina V's and Explorers.
He was making those small Explorers for like Matias and shit. Yeah. Remember he had the mini Explorers? Yeah, he had that one Explorer, the big one with the three black stripes. Yeah. And all of a sudden he started playing the mini ones.
Yeah, those were a Futura.
Oh, wow.
What that is the predates.
Yeah, yeah, the Explorer.
The Explorer.
Yeah, with the weird V headstock.
Yeah, and this guy, Scott, had an original one.
He had an original Futura? Yes,
so that was the guy. So that was when I started making, like, I got into, like, knockoffs.
Yeah. You
know? And got into, like, using old woods and all that kind of shit and really getting into pickups and dynamics of
kind
of
like Max when he was making those Les Pauls for like Slash and everybody.
Pretty much just like that. And this was the guy down in San Diego that was doing it, so I hooked up with him for a while and ran his shop for a minute, and then I came back to Los Angeles in like 95 and started my own thing. It was called G-String Guitar Works, and it was just like basically repairs and setups and shit like that. Nothing, you know, no building yet. Yeah. Just kind of fucking around. And got back into playing music again and shit like that. And just, I still wasn't sure yet what was going on, but I was building and doing custom stuff shortly thereafter. And then I just kind of dipped out completely. I didn't think that I was well suited for the industry. You know, I wasn't fit to be in a shop anymore. I kind of
somebody else's shop.
Anybody else's shop, even my own. You know, I didn't really feel like I was worth it anymore, kind of thing. And not that the drive or the passion or the curiosity wasn't there anymore, or the need or the longing. It was just I had kind of damaged myself at that point, and so I felt like I was not fit to be in a shop, basically.
Yeah.
And you know, I still have all my digits, so
yeah.
That's the main thing. It's like you got to keep your fingers in this gig. You know what
I mean? Yeah, yeah.
And so that was the other thing that kind of, you know, I was like, well, if I'm going to choose this other lifestyle, then I got to, like, make a decision here. So again, I made that decision, and I got into historic restoration.
Oh, wow.
Historic building restoration.
Really?
Yeah, I got into, like, custom corbels and rescreening crown moldings from 100 years ago and
Like going to like people's old craftsmen's or Victorians and restoring them?
Yeah, so I got into turn of the century homes.
Wow.
And got into like all the, when downtown started getting turned over and rebuilt, I was hired by one of the big contractors there to like hang off of the side of buildings and sculpt the new corbels and shit like that, you know?
Wow.
Go into synagogues and start high relief crown moldings and all the different ornamental stuff that was, you know, all the different ornamental plaster stuff and dig buildings.
How you learning that shit? Are you just trial and error?
I think I just wanted to.
You're learn. Just like a wood guy,
I
right?
I just wanted to learn something else.
Right.
Really, and just it seemed like a fucking high-paying job.
Yeah.
That I never made more than $20 an hour, and this was like $35 a fucking hour.
Wow, yeah, yeah.
So I was like, well, I'm just going to do this then. Fuck it. I'll just do this, buy guitars, play in fucking bands, and that's it, you know, and I'll be set. Well, and then I started getting hurt because I'm not built for that. Physically, I'm a little guy, so I'm not really built for like hauling hundreds of fucking pounds of concrete and shit.
Well, that
like
shit
that.
Fucks you up, it man. You know what I mean?
Ass.
Like, I remember I was like, I did a lot of construction growing up, and I still remember like, you know, carrying up that waterproof sheetrock for bathrooms up two flights of stairs, three flights of stairs. Like, fuck this, man. Yeah. Shit weighs like, you know, hundreds of pounds or you know, doing dismantling old bathrooms, like pulling out those steel tubs. Fuck that. The steel tub.
Yeah,
you know?
All those clawfoots with
the clawfoots.
Porcelain and shit. Yeah.
Oh, this shit weighs like 500 pounds and you're trying to get them down stairways. Your body's just fucked. You see all those old guys, man. They're just fucked. That's why they're drinking in bars.
Yeah, I was hanging off a scaffolding like 50 feet in the air and, you know, with the, you know, impact drivers and all kinds of shit like that, and heavy, like, you know, shit that I just, I fell off a couple of scaffoldings.
Wow.
That's what happened. We erected scaffolding to work in this church up off of up in Altadena, and it was just a tower going straight up to this one window sill that was a cast concrete sill that was cracked that they needed repaired. So we had to drill through it, stick a rod in it, and patch it. Well, we had no place to tie off, and the thing just came crashing down with tools and mortar and shit in hand, and just
fucked
that place up.
Whoa.
And I somehow bounced off the floor and didn't get killed.
Unbelievable.
And, yeah, this is insane. So I
you're like a cat. You got shot at. You fell. Yeah. Nine lives.
Yeah. Yeah, I got electrocuted, all kinds of
shit. You probably OD'd a couple times. You know what I mean? You're
like, certainly had the lights out a few times. Yeah. I've been blue, purple, green.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But yeah, I think what happens with some people that are on their path strongly when you see them is that they've been through all this other shit and tested all the other waters,
yeah,
and came back to like, okay, this is what I should be doing if you're lucky enough to get there. So by the time I met my wife and we had our daughter and stuff, I had already kind of been through all the things that I thought I wanted to do.
Yeah. You got it out of your system.
Yeah. And then I was still working construction and doing all that kind of stuff. But she knew about my past and building guitars and stuff like that. And at the time I was in a band called Decry, a local punk rock band. And I didn't have a good humbucker guitar.
Yeah.
And so a friend of mine gave me a basket case SG, and I didn't have a fretboard. It had needed a bunch of work. So she bought me on, this is eBay had just started. This is like
96,
something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. 97. So she bought me, this is a little later on. This is like almost 2000. Maybe.
Right. Right. But eBay's early on. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right.
And so she bought a Les Paul custom fretboard, like an old one that had been scabbed off of Les Paul block inlays with the inlay board, with the ebony board, and I got it, and she's like, here, you can use this to make your, you know, this guitar. And I was like, wow, that's fucking cool of her to do that. And that was the first time where I was like, okay, I'm gonna see if I can, you know, have a little crack at this again. Just kind of, you know, it was just in the back of my mind. I was like, okay, I'm gonna. So I put that guitar together and it came out really cool, and I played it for a bunch of years, and in that interim a couple of friends of mine found out and started hitting me up again. Hey, would you build me this, would you do this, would you do that, and that kind, yeah, of thing. So I got back into more of a hobby kind of thing because I was working, so I didn't need a job, but I was, you know.
Which sometimes makes it better.
Yeah, I was
because you're not doing it for a living.
Yeah, and so at the time I was able to get back into like all the new pickups and all the new shit that was out, because it had been years since I had even poked my head around the industry and saw what was out there. I didn't even know.
Yeah.
You know, and then I started seeing guys like, you know, Dennis Fano and James Troussard and, you know,
Troussard,
some,
yeah,
of these other guys that were doing
Zamitis
art stuff, you know, yeah, and Zamitis, of course, but and started kind of looking at stuff and going, that's interesting that some of the ideas that I had,
especially Troussard, man, because they come on, he comes out of nowhere with these rusted tellies and the Black Crows are playing them, mm-hmm, and you're like, whoa, look at that. And the whole thing about them being metal, it was really like, and that boutique amp era is hitting, Matchless is hitting, and people start realizing, hey, the old stuff's great because it's made by hand and it's all done good. So we want that kind of shit. And this industry starts to boom again on that.
Yeah, yeah, totally. So there was a huge surge of new boutique dudes around again. And this is like 10 years after I had left, you know? So it was interesting that I figured, I was like, well, that's weird, because, and so I went and started playing some of these things and just trying them out and checking them out. And there was a huge gap in what was visually there and sonically there.
So they might look really cool, but sound like shit.
They sounded, played, and felt like ass. Yeah. You know, they just, you know, it didn't match, you know, there was a big gap there. So I got to thinking, you know, and this is just me just kind of pondering, going, huh, I wonder if I could pull off, you know, what I was thinking that I could do like 15 years ago today. You know, I wonder if I could actually make an old new guitar.
Right.
You know? And so I started thinking about different things that I wanted to maybe explore. And we didn't have any fucking money or anything like that. We were just kind of living hand to mouth. And I just kind of, you know, as I was getting more and more injured and shit like that, it just kind of, it came to a point where I was like driving down the street one day, just listening to myself talk in my head, and just I you know, the light went on. It just kind of like went on.
Yeah.
And I remember the conversation that I had with myself years ago.
Yeah.
Like, if, literally in the mirror,
I want to come back to this.
You know, so when it's time, I'll know, kind of thing. And I thought, okay, maybe I've been through all this shit. I've played a bunch. I know what this thing does. I know the ins and outs of the dynamics of different woods and how they interact with each other, what to expect sonically. Just by seeing it and knowing the species, what to expect sonically out of it and how to balance that out. You know, what type of set neck do I use? How big the tenons are that should be used? Why a sliver of a tenon that is common in a Gibson, like a Les Paul or any of the other like SGs and stuff, why it's so different from like a fucking junior. Like a double cut junior has this giant tenon that just goes right in and interlocks with the mass of the body, and it's two big giant chunks of wood locking together to create one thing. I thought, okay, that's the first thing I wanted to do, is that's my staple right there. I'm going to develop that. And then the second thing was I still had with me a guitar that when Leo died, the next day I went into his lab, and the new owners of the company, the McLarens, you know, I was respected because I was running the fucking shop, you know, let me have some time in the lab by myself. And so I went in there he had a little loft area, you know, like storage shit and books and whatnot. And I went up there and I found a body and the templates and a couple of other, you know, little inventions and shit he was working on. Nothing too spectacular, but just tinkering shit. But I found this body and these templates, and the body had never went into production. It was kind of a Tele kind of thing. It's kind of stretched out a little wider, a little longer than a Tele, but nonetheless that kind of single cut bolt on Tele kind of thing. And the templates were there, and they were dated 1969, and that was the Trisonic R&D era.
Whoa.
So Trisonic R&D was a company that Leo and George started to basically still work under their no competition clause that they had with CBS when they sold CBS.
Right.
So they erected this little R&D company so that they could still tinker and fuck around.
Kind of like Marshall with Park.
Exactly.
Park amps. Yeah.
Well, Park was different. Park was a way for Marshall, for Ken Brand to make amps and make money at making amps without, because they were locked into a fucking a deal with a distribution company at the time.
Oh, I got it.
They couldn't do shit outside of the distribution company.
Right.
They couldn't have other dealers. They couldn't sell to anybody else. It all had to go through the distributor. So they put up Kitchen Marshall, Park, and I think there was one more, but Narb was the last one they did, and that's Ken Brand's last name backwards.
Oh, wow.
So he was doing all Plexi era stuff.
Sick.
So that was the last kind of off brand of Marshall that Ken Brand did, and I actually acquired that trademark last year. So,
wow.
So we're gonna be making the Narbs out of Detroit.
That's fucking killer, man.
Yeah, yeah. So there's a bunch of stuff.
So
like
you got that you got that Fender that piece out of Fender.
Yeah, I had that guitar with me, and I was like, okay, all the bolt-on shit that I want to do is going to be based off of this guitar, because it's Leo's last fucking thing, you know? And it wasn't ever announced. Nobody ever fucking knew about it, so I took it back to GNL when I first started having the conversations with myself again to get back into guitar making. I took that guitar down to GNL, and said, this was like, I think this was like 2009.
Yeah.
I took that guitar down to G&L.
They're still open?
Yeah.
Wow.
And I said, hey, you know, I'm getting ready to start something. And I have this guitar. I've had this guitar since Leo fucking passed away. It's the last one that here's the templates, here's the guitar. You guys should have it. You guys should make this fucking thing.
Yeah.
And on the way down there, I was like, okay, I'm going to give this thing away. I'm going to fucking give this thing to these guys. If they reject it, or if they don't, are wishy-washy, I'm going to take that as a fucking green light.
Yeah.
You know? So I went down there and met with the heads and the fucking McLarens and shit, and they remembered everything, and it was like, oh, how you doing, blah, 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 good to see you, this and that. And they hooked me up with corporate, and then their artist and relations department, which I thought was fucking lame, because it was like, so I started going through the suits to get the thing, and I tried to get them to make the fucking thing.
Right.
And they rejected it completely. So I just said, fuck it. That's the sign that I want, right? That's, if there's a green light and a go, that's it. So on the way back home, you know, I kind of just had that other conversation.
You said, this is going to be my shape and everything.
Yeah. So I just said, all right.
And was that the headstock was there too and stuff?
Headstock wasn't there yet. No, nothing like that. It was
just the body shape.
Just that body shape. And then I knew I wanted to do like junior bass kind of stuff, you know. Just,
1P90 stuff?
Yeah. You know, that had to be developed yet. I was sure that I wanted to go down all kinds of sonic roads as far as pickups were concerned, but I wanted to, you know, I wanted to have my set neck deal done and my bolt on deal.
So that becomes done. The shape that you start Echopark Guitars with.
Yeah. Yeah. The double cut junior type thing. And then I had a Supro dual tone at the time.
Which one is it? Is it this body here? Let's see. Is it this one?
Yeah, it's that style.
So it looks like a kind of a, like a just a bigger telly.
It's like a stretched out telly kind
of thing. Yeah, it is. Yeah. Yeah, weird. So that becomes your jumping off point as that's going to be your signature shape.
Yeah. Yeah, so it turned into a bunch of different stuff, you know.
Wow.
Cuz I realized that you could stick a Jazzmaster trim on it. You could put, you know, it had enough room physically to house a bunch of different, you know, a bunch of different types of stuff. And so I could explore different styles within that wheelhouse. So that's when I was like, that's when I started looking at like the Tussauds and the other, you know, Thanos and whatnot. It was like a list, you know. And I started realizing that the one thing that they didn't do that I could do was build a guitar from the inside out. Like a real one, you know, like, and because I knew manufacturing, and those guys, none of those guys manufactured.
Right.
I mean, James to this day still doesn't build guitars. He just.
Trussart?
Yeah, he doesn't build guitars. He's never built guitars.
He doesn't build them?
No, fuck no. He's never built guitars. He's always put them together from other people's parts.
Oh, it's kind of like, you know, like all these guys where they just buy these body blanks and everything and they just put them together. Yeah, wow.
Yeah, they're assemblers. They're
good. Well, who was doing his bodies and stuff?
These guys in France originally, and then now he has them done here, CNC, you know, here.
Oh, wow.
And I think either Grover Jackson or who is it that's doing his necks? There's another guy down in...
So he's just an assembler.
He doesn't touch them. He's got a couple of guys that do all that shit for him.
Wow.
He's got a couple of knobs that just, you know.
So you are building everything from the ground. Are you winding your own pickups and shit?
No, Rob Timmons from Arcane Inc. We've been working together, and that guy's been in the business as long as I have. And he started with Michael Tobias back in 1990.
Wow.
He went to school, Roberto Van School of Luthery in Arizona. He actually went to school to learn this shit. So he was ghost building for like Fernandez and I think Charvel and, you know, James Jussard, all these guys. He was ghost building and providing pickups for these guys.
That's incredible. These guys are all like, they're not even building their own stuff. You think you're getting a custom-made boutique guitar, and it's just a fucking bolt together.
Yeah, that's
kind of like those shitty chopper shops when West Coast choppers hit. People are like, you know, oh, I'll just build choppers. So they're buying Daytech frames, they're buying an S&S engine.
It's like Shinola.
Yeah.
In fucking Detroit. It's like there's posters everywhere, fucking Shinola made in Detroit. You go in there and there's boxes from China and they're assembling the shit. You know, it's like,
oh, is that the watch company?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
That's bullshit.
It's Shinola.
Oh, shit. Shit Shinola. You know what I mean? They're giving you the Shinola.
Exactly. So I decided early on, that was one of the things that was like, I don't want to ever fucking do that. You know, that's like, why even bother?
Yeah.
You know, what the fuck is the point? So the lure and the lust and the desire to do something from the inside out was really where I was coming from.
That's the fucking art of it, man.
Yeah. And then,
you know what I mean?
And going back to the influence of my dad, you know, it was like, I watched that dude do rapidograph, fucking monstrous image, like portraits of like, walnuts and shit like that at a little tiny dot.
Just the dot. Little dots
and they make these giant walnuts on, you know, there's no other way to do it except put the time in.
Yeah.
You know?
It's just like comedy. You know what I mean? It's like stand up comedy.
Yeah.
These guys just want to fucking, you know, get 5 minutes together and go, hey, I wanna be a star. And it's like,
you have to live it.
You gotta go out and eat dicks, man. Yeah, yeah. You know what I mean? You gotta live it, just like you're saying.
Yeah, you have to live it. So when I came back to guitar making, I had the historic restoration thing under my belt, the guitar making thing under my belt, the drug thing under my belt, the rock and roll thing under my fucking pussy and eating and fucking all that shit under my proverbial belt. And now I was a father, you know, a young father with a young wife, and looking at the rest of my days here and thinking,
gotta provide.
Thinking like, what the fuck is the best thing that I can do? You know, what is the best thing I can do? You know, yeah, I want to play rock and roll.
Yeah.
Yeah, I want to be on stage. Yeah, I want to record and produce and all that shit. What's going to be the thing that I can actually set myself apart from everybody else with? You know, because there's already 10 billion of that right now. I'm not going to make a dent. What could I make a dent with? You know?
Yeah.
And that's kind of when it all kind of started, you know, circling the funnel again. And I started realizing that I had enough experience and I had enough fresh ideas to actually put something together that would not just make an impact on just the dudes that I knew, but I thought, well, if these guys are getting away with this shit on the just strictly on the visual, you know, then I know I could fucking kill it, you know.
Because if you have visual and it fucking caresses in your hand, it sounds great.
Yeah,
you're gonna be miles away.
Yeah. So the first guitars I made, I want to say the first five sold like fucking overnight.
And where did you sell them at? Stores or just walking around showing people?
There was a store down in LA, and then they put it on consignment for about a week. And then there was a guy in New York that bought a couple, and then Johnny Two Bags and I started working together, and I developed some stuff with him, and then he went on the road with like the first junior that I made, like the first double cut.
Right.
Because they had just come out with a new record and he needed this particular thing on an outro solo that he did. I think it was like a California Hustle and Flow, I think was the name of the song.
Right.
So they did this, they were getting ready to do this whole tour. And so he came by and he grabbed that guitar and fell in love with it. And it was like a humbucker bass junior.
Was it called Echopark Guitars out of the gate?
I came up with Echopark. I was working with Mike Lippi, who was actually one of my early mentors. And we started making some guitars together. We made about five together initially. Because what had happened is I got this idea to make the company. I made the first guitar in my backyard. We didn't have shit. I had like a fucking, I went out and applied for like a $500 credit card.
Yeah.
Because my back was fucked up and I didn't have a gig. I was living on unemployment and shit like that. My wife had a job, but we had a kid, you know? So my wife was like, yeah, okay, I think, yeah, this is a good, you should do this, you know. So I went and got like a 6-inch joiner. I went to Home Depot and spent like $500 on just little hand tools, basically. So I had like 3 power tools, and I made this junior, and I got that junior out into the public, and that's
what did it sell for?
I still have it. I never sold it. Yeah,
but early on, like the first 5 that sell, you don't know what, like what kind of price tag to put on them, right?
The first one that I actually sold was sold for like $1,800.
Wow,
you know. And then I started making the clearance models, which are the Tele style things, uh-huh. And those sold for around the same price, and it was only 2 of them.
Yeah.
And then I made the Ghetto Bird and the Downtowner Custom Koa, and
yeah, the Ghetto Bird's killer.
The El Caballo and a La Carne. I wanted to design a full line. I was like, okay, where am I going to go with this? Okay, I know what I don't want to do. What do I want to do? I want to do like American vintage Gibson and Fender inspired, you know, pretty.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, the Downtowner, it's interesting. It's kind of like a Les Paul Junior, you know, and it has the 2 knobs, classic with the wraparound bridge and stuff. But it definitely has your own flavor. And then the El Caballo, is that what it's called? Uh-huh. It looks like the old Epiphones, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's cool. And then the Ghetto Bird is just fucking cool as shit, man. It's a spinoff of a Firebird, mm-hmm. non-reverse Firebird, mm-hmm. which is just beautiful.
Yeah.
Now, some of these other ones kind of look like, you know, your own shape, like the Bakersfield.
That's actually like... Moss Wright Ventures model.
Oh, that is that. Yeah, just blew it up. Yeah. Yeah.
And then there's the Corvette, which is the inspired by the Cornet, but I mean not the Cornet, but the Arroyo is inspired by the Corvette, the Gretsch Corvette.
Yeah.
So I wanted to do more slabby, kind of thick, you know, hardy shit, and just kind of take basically those older designs and just kind of beef them up,
without
putting humbuckers, you know, like literally just make them thicker, you know, make them the way that they kind of should have been made, you know, more.
Yeah, because back in the day, they were just made real shitty.
Yeah,
those 59 TV juniors and stuff are just there. I mean, those were just shitty guitars.
They were considered,
but they had a sound, man.
Models, you know, what they're considered, but. I wanted to kind of base everything off of that, you know, and just kind of circle around that magic, you know.
Are you painting them yourself?
Yeah.
You using nitro?
All of it, yeah.
Oh, only, yeah. And then cloth wiring?
All of it.
Yeah.
It's all cloth wire. It's all, you know, paper and oil capacitors. And,
yeah.
You know, all that kind of 50s wiring schematics and the whole bit, you know.
And at what point do some celebrities start sniffing around? Because I'm just going to give you guys a rundown of who's playing these. Joe Perry, Brad Whitford, of course. Those guys are guitar freaks, and they have all kinds of shit. Johnny Depp, he'll play anything that Joe Perry plays. Nick Oliveri, who is an absolute god. Josh Homme, of course. All of the Queens guys play these. Dave Catching, you know, Eagles of Death Metal. Phil X from Bon Jovi right now. Jackson Brown, pretty fucking cool. Troy Van Leeuwen, a lot of people that have been on this show. Who's the first guy that really gets into it, celebrity-wise?
I was working with Johnny.
Johnny Depp?
Yeah, no, Johnny Two Bags.
Oh, I gotcha.
From Social D.
Yeah.
And he was like the first, I guess, if you want to call somebody a celebrity.
Yeah, I mean, it's a Social D.
No, notoriety. But he was the first guy that, and he brought with him like his love of juniors and slab body, you know, tellies and the whole Blackguard thing and all that. And so we really...
That's a very junior band, too.
Yeah.
I mean, even though Mike Ness plays that Les Paul, you know, but it's, you know, like Drug Train with the slide, all that sound is, it's very P90, you know?
Yeah, it's all P90. It's all, you know, syrupy, you know, plexi.
Yep.
You know, blackface, basement kind of thing, you know?
It's rockabilly on fucking steroids.
Yeah, and so that was the first guy to come along, and he brought with him a friend of his, David Kalish. And David Kalish is a guitar collector, reseller, but and he's been, he kind of, was one of the first guys in LA, like back in the 70s, to start like flipping gear and doing all that kind
like
of,
Norm Harris.
Yeah, exactly. He was before him.
Yeah.
And so he brought him along, and I got to meet that guy, and he really was one of the key guys early on that said, okay, if you're going to make these style guitars, there's certain things you gotta hone in on. So it was like neck pitch, tapered headstocks, you know, neck shapes, things like that. So we talk about this shit every day. And
no shit, huh?
Yeah, so I got my hands on some early 30s arch tops and things like that, and just started kind of going back to school and remembering, like, okay, I remember that Epiphone I had when I was like 22, sitting in the park jacked on heroin,
yeah,
playing this fucking thing for days on end, and it just played like fucking butter.
Yeah.
And I never... because I was playing then, I wasn't.
Yeah, you're not thinking about the build.
I'm not thinking about that. I'm just enjoying the guitar, and so I got to like circle back and like remember. Oh, that's okay. Now it starts to make sense as to why these things were built a certain way and what they did and why the neck shapes were the way they were, and then and the neck pitches and all that kind of shit and the different other elements and dimensions and stuff like that. So he kind of refocused my attention on the details, you know. And so when I did the first guitar for Johnny, all that stuff was very on purpose. It had to have, there was a list of stuff that it had to have. And so we nailed all that stuff. And they never said, okay, here's three guitars, you just use these and cut. I didn't get anything from him or anybody. It was just like, okay, this is the color. And yeah, it's a downtowner with one P90 and a wrap around the rest. Go for it. So I just kind of built it kind of by osmosis, you know, by Braille, I guess.
And from memory and everything.
Just from feel, you know. Just like, okay, I know how it's got to feel. I'm just going to go with that. And that's still kind of how I do it, you know. It's just...
wow.
You know, you lock into certain elements, certain ingredients in your recipes, and you just kind of... that's what you do. So, but David Kalish really helped me a lot, because he got me focused on... I'm not
the Venice aspects.
The you know, beyond the aesthetics and beyond the wood, even, like, here's the actual numbers and details that you have to fucking perfect and be consistent with.
You know? There's no Brazilian rosewood fretboards anymore, right? Can you get that?
Oh yeah.
You can get it?
I have a stash.
Wow.
Yeah, I started collecting wood when I was pretty young.
Yeah.
And just managed to hang on to it. Because, you know, it was worthless at some... Yeah. There was a point where it was like...
absolutely. I mean, there was a point where Gibson got raided, right?
Yeah.
And for all their exotic woods, like 5 years ago or something.
Yeah, they were being stupid. And the owner of that company is a fucking idiot, so...
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a total... yeah, he's as bad as our president.
You ever meet Tom Murphy?
Never did. No, no.
Dying to have him on the show, man.
Oh.
I mean, just because of, like, you know, what he was doing early on with the Murphy Pauls, you know, in like 96, you know, that shit was like, hey, these guitars are junk. I'm going to make these better, you know? And there's guys like Tom Murphy and what was his name? John English or whatever at Fender, all the master builders and stuff. That stuff really kind of kicked people back into loving guitars, I think.
Yeah, I think it turned people on to what was no more, you know. Things weren't available like that anymore,
right?
You know, and so there was a market, you know. There was a market for beat up guitars, basically.
Yeah.
You know, beat up old American guitars again. And they were not obtainable to the common man at that point. So, they created a marketplace for it. So I kind of jumped in on the tail end of that whole deal. And looking back, you know, there was like, what was it, 2010, 2011? It was kind of the end of that era almost, you know, and kind of the ship had sailed already. So what happened next for me was I got a call from a buddy who was a friend of Nick's, actually.
Nick Oliveri.
And he had a friend. His friend was Brad Whitford's guitar tech.
Wow.
And he got a hold of him and called him, and he went on the website. And back then, I had like 3 models or something like that. There was really nothing available. It was just kind of like, I I look at that now and go, fuck, I don't even know how I did that, you know?
Yeah.
But, like, he called me and said, hey, I think Brad's would be interested in some of these. What would, you know, what would you put together, or what do you have available? At the time, I had just done the guitar for Johnny, and I was working on a second one with humbuckers and gold and that kind of thing. So yeah. That wound up being Brad's guitar.
Wow, yeah, there it is, man. Now, does he play it live?
He does, yeah. He does play it live. And did it. They recorded that whole record with Jack Douglas, that last one that they did. And that guitar wound up being on the record, like, pretty much 100% of
wow.
Brad's tracks.
So when he does he come out to meet you?
No, what happened is they had asked me to ship some stuff out to Vindaloo, which was, you know, their Boston headquarters. And, you know, obviously I'm fucking shaking in my boots, you know, and stoked as fuck. But yeah. I didn't yet have the wherewithal to do those, you know, shipping and all that shit. I didn't know anything.
Yeah, shipping and all that.
No, man, I'm not going to do
You're
that.
You're like an old punk rock junkie. You're like, shipping? Can't you just pick it up?
Yeah, just go get it, man. And so what happened is, I kind of thought the deal fell through because I wasn't able to ship anything. I didn't want to anyways.
Yeah.
And a friend of mine came through. I was working out of this place called Bedrock Studios at the time. And I was doing repairs and stuff and building guitars. And I was just starting to get the guitars rolling. And I started to do repair work again and stuff like that. And a buddy of mine came through that owns a studio in town. And we were talking, and I said, man, I got to ask you a question. What do you think about, like, this? And I told him, I got this commission from the guys in Aerosmith to build them a couple of guitars. They're done. I don't want to ship them. What do you think I should do? He's like, well, ironically enough, after the South American tour, they're going to be at my studio finishing the record with Jack Douglas here in L.A.
Wow.
And that's in June. And this was, like, I think it was, like, April or is like around April.
Yeah.
Said in June they'll be here in LA, so you can just come down with the shit then. I said, fuck, that's great, you know. So I went back to work and finished out, like, I think I finished about 10 guitars in the interim, and one of them was the Ghetto Bird, a couple of Downtowners, a couple of Clarence Rose models, you know, a variety of things. So I had about 7 pieces, 8 pieces done, finished when they landed. So they started working in earnest around June, July, and I called my friend and said, hey, you know, these things are done, I'd like to get down there. He said, okay, I'll put you in touch with, you know, Marco Moyer, who was Brad's tech at the time. And so I went down there with the guitars, and, you know, we set them up and stuff like that, and I got to go through Joe's stuff and hang out for a bit. And then I split, and I got a call from Jack Douglas the next day.
Yeah.
He said, hey, I want to meet you. Come down, you know? So I went down and met Jack Douglas, and it's fucking Jack Douglas.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, he did Imagine and,
yeah,
and all this other shit, you know? And I'm just, so I'm like, dude, like, fuck all this guitar shit.
Yeah, you made some fucking master records,
you're
man.
You're Jack Douglas.
You yeah, know, yeah, like, yeah.
The soundtrack of my fucking life.
Yeah.
You know, kind of thing. And so we got to chopping it up real heavy, and he's an ex-junkie and all that shit, you know?
Yeah.
So we're just hanging out, and he's like, hey, I'm gonna call Joe right now and just, like, you know, and, you know, see what's up. So I guess that night he'd emailed Joe a bunch of pictures of the guitars that I had dropped off. And Joe got back to him and said, hey, call this cat down here. I wanna meet this guy.
Wow.
So I went down there and brought the old Clarence that I had, the old, you know, guitar that I found in the attic, and I'm coming through the hallway, and there's Steven comes out. He's like, hey, man, fucking your guitars are just, you know, he starts like complimenting me. Like,
wow.
I just met him, you know.
Yeah, yeah, like, yeah. Steven Tyler's just like, that shit sounds great.
We weren't even formally introduced. It was like immediate, like, hugs and the whole thing. And he's just like, yeah, man, Joe's waiting for you inside the control room. Come on back. So, and it was like,
this is sick.
It was crazy. So, wow. Like, all these guys are like standing around Joe and I.
Yeah.
We get introduced, and I have a picture of it somewhere. And it's just like one of the heaviest.
Yeah, right, Joe Perry, man. I mean, fucking, you got to think about the guy owned some of the best flame top Les Pauls, that one that Slash gave him for back to him. Yeah. And, you know, and he had all the coolest guitars of BC Rich's back in the day, the 10 string and all that.
He was one of the first guys to really play like a bunch of different shit.
Yep. Yep.
You know, a bunch of different shit that nobody even knew about.
And he had like the five different fucking amps on stage always. It was like sick.
And Brad got him into that shit. You know, Brad was the one that turned him on to all the wacky
shit.
Brad
Whitford.
So, yeah. Yeah. So when I got to hook up with Brad, it was like talking about that influence in music and technique. And with Joe, it was like esoteric, like fucking, you know, magic and shit. And so I found myself,
a couple old junkies just come say,
I found myself hanging out with him and Steven and Jack in the control room for like 4 days.
Whoa.
Yeah, they invited that, like every day. It was just like, come on, what time are you gonna be here? So I'd come down, and then there was a rack of guitars that just kind of lived there, and I don't think Joe had played any of them for about a week. And then one day I was talking with his wife, and we were talking about art, and she's an artist. And I was telling her about the rose patterns and how I accomplished it, you know, via screen art. And she's like, oh, I got to see this. So we go back in the big guitar room, and all the guitars are lined up there, and all his shit, and just tons of shit, and then the four or five guitars that I still had left there. And she saw the Ghetto Bird, and she's like, has Joe seen this? I said, yeah, he's seen it. He's seen all these. And she's like, is he playing them? I said, I don't know. That's not my, I can't do that.
You know? Yeah.
I said, you know, he's Joe Perry. I can't.
Yeah. Hey, play these.
Yeah, I can't do that.
Right.
So she's like, well, I can.
Yeah.
And she grabbed like two of them off the rack, and she marched into the room, and they were firing up the Marshalls to get ready to start recording. She's like, Joe, play this. And she put the thing in his hands, and he played it and played it and played it and couldn't stop. And it's just kind of like, I remember it like he's done more coke than we spilled on the fucking floor. You know what I mean? And, you know, I mean, he's so there's snot dripping out of his nose, and he's just going for it, you know?
Yeah.
He's just in the control room, dimly lit, and he like wipes his fucking nose and looks up at me. He's like, fuck, brother. This is amazing. How did you do this? And Steven's there and Jack's there. It's kind of one of those huddled, quiet moments. And his wife, Billy, is sitting there. And he starts asking me questions about it. And we got into another 4 or 5 days of hanging out.
Whoa.
And he bought all those guitars.
All of them?
Yeah.
Wow.
So he kind of wiped
out. You gotta be shitting your pants.
Yeah, so, and then Steven, of course, has to top that. So he bought, you know, he commissioned me to make him a couple and Brad a couple immediately. So the first money that I made was from those guys.
That's fucking great,
and,
man.
And we were like fucking baroque. I mean, getting close to like having to move in with mom broke.
Whoa.
And they basically saved my fucking ass.
That is amazing. Yeah. Does he hit you up still? Like, hey, I'm ready for another one?
I just kind of like I'm building one for him now, and he'll get it when it's done. And,
yeah.
You know, he's works with other people. And
I love this one that he has here, the hardtail, this one.
Yeah, that's the Ghetto Bird.
Yeah, but it's like a hardtail one, mm-hmm. man. It's a one, it's a one knob. And it's just fucking killer. It's got a Koa top, Honduras chambered body.
Yeah.
This shit is fucking great, dude.
Yeah, that was the first one. That was the one that Billy put in his hands.
Oh, no shit.
Yeah, that was the guitar.
Oh, that's the one, man. Now, so you're moving to Detroit. You've just closed your shop here, and you've moved to Detroit. Why do you pick Detroit? Is because it's cheap, and what's it like out there right now? Because I watched this thing about 4 years ago that Johnny Knoxville did a thing for Cadillac where it was like Detroit is alive and well. And he was showing these people that were coming out there and doing cool shit. Like one guy bought a full fucking five-story building. It's like the top floor was like a skate park and the middle floor was like, you know, like a yo-yo factory or whatever. There was a bunch of urban farming going on, mm-hmm. and as much as Detroit was completely dead, a lot of people were leaving, like rich hipsters and stuff from New York, or like, fuck it, I'll just grab this whole building and live in this monster loft and do my life here.
Yeah, there's so I got hip to Detroit about 5 or 6 years ago from a buddy of mine out in Las Vegas, and we started talking about, you know, the climate and, you know, different, you know, we're fathers and stuff like that, and just, you know, I wanted to buy a house maybe, you know, that kind of shit. And I had been working, you know, pretty hard at that point. And so it kind of got on my periphery. And as we grew and, you know, I was building and started working with guys in Queens, and just started kind of growing and growing and growing, you know, the hours of work got longer, the demand got higher. And
it's still just you?
It's still just me. I'd hired an assistant at that point a couple of years back and got a finisher under my belt. So I had, you know, two other guys that I was working and training and working with. And then I started doing amps with my friend Eric.
Yeah, I can't find the amps on your site.
Yeah, you gotta, if you go to, I think you gotta go back to the front.
Okay.
Kind of thing. Here, going
online store. Yeah. Oh, here we go. Amplifiers, because I remember seeing them on your Instagram. Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's a little hokey to navigate right now. We're changing the whole website.
Yeah. So you're building amps too, and are the amps Fender based, EL84s, 34s, Marshall based? What are they?
6L6.
6L6 is Fender based.
7581.
It's all Fender stuff?
It's Fender Ampeg-ish.
Gotcha.
Kind of thing, very American, very chesty, you know.
Yeah.
Not so squishy, you know. I'm not really a 34 kind of guy. I like more American voice stuff personally.
I like the Tweed Deluxe. Yeah. I think the Victoria Double Tweed Deluxe, the Double Deluxe, is the finest amp ever made as far as a boutique amp for me. Because you get that Neil Young thing, but you got some more headroom instead of the 112 breaking up right away. You got 212s.
Yeah.
And I thought that they really killed it with the Tweed reissues, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah, they did a great job.
Yeah, they really did, man.
And that was the first thing. So I was thinking, you know, I like silver tones. Those are kind of like my thing. And 1484s, 1482s, 1483s mostly. The 1483s are just like a really poor man's bassman. You know, you get that little head and stick it through a 212 and it's fucking ass kicking.
The bassman's the finest amp ever made. The Tweed bassman, the 59-4 input Tweed bassman. Yep. I don't think there's a better amp made, but you need to turn that fucker up, and most clubs you can't play that.
So, yeah.
So that's where the Tweed Deluxe comes in, you know?
Yeah, and I got a couple of those, but so I started thinking about, like, you know, if I could do that, what would I do? You know, and my favorite amp is a Deluxe, but they're still a little too loud, I think.
Deluxe? Tweed Deluxe?
Well, Blackface.
Oh, Blackface. That is the most smoking amp ever. Chuck Prophet turned me into that, like a lover of that. And it is loud, but man, what a fucking amp, right?
So I was thinking, well, if I could do something between a Princeton and a Deluxe, you know, but still have like that simplicity of a Silvertone, you know, that's kind of what I was thinking. So right around that time, I'd hooked up with this guy, Adam, down in San Diego, who built Satellite amps, I thought he built them anyways. Anyway, the guy that actually built them was Eric Bernstorff, and he built and taught him how to build and all that kind of shit, and helped him start his company and all that kind of stuff. Him and I got to hanging out a lot, because we had the same, you know, we were just like the same dude, basically. So he had actually, he left Satellite and started his own thing, and then that thing was kind of funded by a money guy, you know, and that always is bad, you know.
Yeah, totally.
So the money guy started acting like he was the artist, you know, the builder, and just stuck his foot in his fucking mouth all the time.
Yeah.
And you know, you know, just coming on too strong and being a fucking douchebag, basically. So I had the idea that if I can get Eric to work with me on amps, that we could probably design some shit that could be pretty awesome and useful. Right around that time, I was working with Troy on his new...
Van Leeuwen?
Yeah, on his new setup for that tour, for that tour that they did for like Clockwork.
That record's so smoking.
It's amazing.
It's insane, that record.
Yeah, so I was working with him a lot, and something had happened to his AC-30s, and Bob Dixon couldn't work on them, so I called Eric. And I had Eric down, and we were just kind of going through them and just checking them out. And we just started talking. And this is right when Eric's company was starting to just tank. And so I called Troy, and I said, hey, you know, I'm thinking about putting a thing, doing some amps and shit. What do you think you'd like to do? He said, well, you know, I'll bring some shit down. So him and I have basically the same kind of stuff. He, you know, he had some AC-30s and his black face bass fins, and those are the primary things, and then like a Jubilee head.
Love the Jubilee.
So he brought all that stuff down, and we just kind of sat around for about a week listening to different amps, and just he had a collection, I had a collection. And then I called Eric and said, hey, can you bring down some shit, and we'll start talking about, like, you know, fixing these and, you know, kind of souping them up a little so that they could be dependable, and, you know, maybe take the best of his collection and dial it in so that he could go on the road with it. So during that process, it occurred to me that we're doing all this work, we might as well just build a fucking amp, you know? So I had went to Texas for about a week to visit a friend. And during that trip, I bought a Brown Era Pro.
Oh, yeah.
And it was a single 12 that was converted from a single 15, but it was a Brown Era Pro with that really badass tremolo.
Yeah. I never understood those Brown amps, man. Like, Joe Bonamassa's got a bunch of them, but I was like, I don't get this amp. I never got it.
They're post-tweed, pre-blackface.
Yeah, you're like, what is this? What's the sound? It doesn't have a thing, you know?
Yeah, but I love that. You know, I fucking love that they're just like right in the middle somewhere.
It's a bizarre era, right?
And they always sound fucking awesome. And so I bought this amp, and I brought it home, and I went straight to Eric's, and I said, man, this fucking amp right here is like, this is the one.
Yeah.
Like, this is the amp that we all want, you know, really, because it's, you know, it's right around 45 watts. It's got just a creamy breakup at high volumes and cleans up really killer. It's got all the inputs sound different. The tonal range is awesome. The only problem was it didn't have a mid-range control.
Oh, wow.
And if you're using P90s or mahogany kind of guitars, you really want that.
Yeah, or else it's just going to be too muddy.
Yeah, so it was kind of like that thing. So that was what we did. And we took the amp that he had already designed, which was the little white amp. He took and used the white amp circuit. We like obscure shit, and so the white amp is a really obscure Fender amp.
Right.
So we liked the 9-watt kind of thing, the really low watt single ended thing. So instead of a champ, we used that circuit because it's just a much more musical circuit for some reason. Like, champs just are dinky sounding.
Well, they're one thing. It's just dirt, you know, full distortion.
Yeah, whereas this little guy had a range, you know, so we took that as our 9-watt, and then we took the Pro and powered it down and took, we had a couple of Princetons that we had souped up. He had one that he had souped up over the years, and I had one that I had souped up over the years, and we compared the two and kind of came up with a selection of diodes and input circuitry that kind of meshed the two together.
Right.
You know, without compromising anything. We actually got rid of some of the feedback loop and shit like that. And voiced it differently on the inputs. And it just wound up being really marvelous, like a really low-powered, loud little fucking amp that wasn't like a Mesa Boogie or anything like that, but just still in its class, which was about 12 watts, but just so much more headroom and girth to it, you know? So we started fucking around with that shit, and then Troy came into the picture again, and we started fucking around with the 45A head.
Wow.
Which was, I wanted it to have like an American voice and a British voice, but not be so AC-30 spiky.
Yeah.
You know, still have a nice chest and a nice warm round bottom to it. With not the spiky highs, but more rounded. So we fucked with the EQ and fucked with the feedback loops and then added the mid-range circuit to the whole thing and really got it to dial in. And that was the amp that we designed with Troy's rig in mind.
Wow. So he's using that one?
He's been using that ever since.
Now, they all point-to-point?
Oh, yeah.
And then you're making the chassis, the metal boxes and everything?
The chassis are manufactured by this company in up in the valley called Chapman Engineering.
Oh, yeah, I know.
And they do mostly like race car shit, you know. But,
yeah.
But the owner, the son's owner is like a guitar guy. So he actually was doing like pedal boards and shit like that and got into chassis because nobody else was really making.
Yeah.
And we wanted aluminum chassis and not steel ones.
Yeah.
So we got hooked up with them, designed everything, got it out.
And you got what? Two models. So you got the 45 and then the small one?
There's three. There's actually four. There's the Vibramatic 13, yeah, which is a 13 watt, kind of like a deluxe, but a little bit lower power than a deluxe. So right in between there.
Right.
And that thing smokes. And that actually wound up in Joe Perry's rig permanently. And he'd been using that ever since we started making those. But there's a 210 version of that. And there's a single 12 version of that. And there's a Marshall that was designed back in the, I want to say the late 60s. It's a combo. It's a 210 combo. It's like an 18 watt.
Oh, yeah.
One of the things that they sold over in the UK, they weren't offering them here. And Eric's friend had one, original one. So I got to hear that and decided to go with the 210 thing and the single 12 and off-air variation there. And then the 9-watt amp. And then so the last amp that we designed was the Vibramatic 23. And that's pretty much taking off what the 13 is, but it's just a head.
Yeah.
And we went with a solid-state rectifier to tighten up the bottom and get rid of that extra tube, you know, and something that was ran a little cooler, you know, because some of the wall voltages, especially in California, can go from 120 up to fucking 130.
Wow, it just varies that much,
yeah,
huh?
It's a lot of heat. So we had to like design it so that it could take a lot of heat, and you know, very specifically. So, but that amp, there was a call. Charlie Starr from Blackberry Smoke.
Yeah,
he went on tour with one of the heads, one of the big heads like Troy's, and just it was too much. You know, it was just too loud for those guys.
No shit.
Yeah, ironically, and so he said, if you could make this a little smaller into a head, and we had already had the Vibramatic, so I gave him a Vibramatic 210, and he went out on the road with that and did a tour, came back and said, hey, if you could do this, you know, yeah, make it into a head with this. So he got the first one, and after, I think, while we were designing it and building it, Troy came by, and he heard that thing, and he took it to rehearsal, and Dean called me the next day, and he's like, hey, man,
yeah,
you know, I'm having trouble with, I think he was using...
Orange or something?
It wasn't orange, it was, what was it? Anyways, I probably shouldn't be saying this.
Yeah, whatever.
But he was using some other shit, and he called me and said, "Hey, you know, could I get one of those?" So we hooked him. Actually, Dean was the first one to get the full rig, where it was just like,
wow,
a Vibramatic 13 210 combo, the head and the cabinet.
That's sick, man.
For his rig, and then Troy wound up adding that to his rig, and so he wound up using it for his slide and keys, and then the big amp for the guitars because he needed headroom for the pedals and stuff like that. And so they toured with that stuff, and that amp is actually fucking awesome. The next cycle of touring that they did was to get ready for the Iggy Pop thing.
Yeah.
So when they were all getting ready for that, they had their rigs and stuff like that, and I was kind of intimately involved with those guys in terms of the tones and things like that, and we're all just good friends, and I got a call from Josh one day, and he said, hey, you know, I'm kind of bummed out. I don't have one of these.
Yeah.
You know, what's going on? I said, hey, man, I don't want to, like...
Come get it, man.
I don't want to, like, you know, I'm not force-feeding anybody here, you know? So I put a rig together for him, and he... It wound up, basically, the whole fucking tour was backlined by us.
Sick, you know, man. And what are the amps called? Just Echopark amps?
Yeah, Echopark amps.
And now you're in Detroit.
Mm-hmm.
And so I interrupted you on that because I get excited on amps. You had heard about Detroit, so you go out and you check it out. And you know, what is the landscape of Detroit right now? Is it still completely in shambles, or is it like, is that like all fake press news shit, you know? Is it actually happening? Because I remember there was a time like when Jack White and Meg were living there, and I read this thing about there was this neighborhood where all the billionaire automotive industry people lived, and there were these old fucking like Victorian mansions with like Italian marble and all hand-carved fucking crown molding, and these places are supposed to be insane. And I guess Jack White bought one back then for like $200,000, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that exists. I mean, it's really... It's a peculiar landscape, you know. It's kind of like if you took the deepest parts of South Central and parked them right up against Beverly Hills and Westwood, and then took a part of Silver Lake and Echo Park and parked it on the other side.
Yeah.
You know?
So it's that. It's hipsters, ghetto, and rich.
Yeah.
And they're all right on top of each other.
Yeah. And it's kind of a trip, man. I mean, when I went there the first time, it was last year in August. I just kind of got sick of hearing about it, really. And just, we had already looked at a bunch of properties and houses from Washington, you know, in Oregon all the way to fucking Tennessee. You know?
Yeah, so right. Because those are the cool spots. Like, I was just in Portland all weekend. I was like, I love it here.
Yeah.
But then, you know, like, it's pricey too now.
Yeah, I just didn't, I couldn't really, I knew that what I was looking for myself, for my art, was a place where I could land, still have all the things that I needed as far as raw materials and shipping, climate, all that kind of shit. And I didn't really have any, I don't want to say competition, but I didn't want to encroach on anybody else's territory.
Yeah, either, right.
You know, so I kind of wanted to be in a place where I could kind of live and work and do my thing without thinking about anybody else. You know, not that I do here, but it'd be better if I didn't have that in my periphery. So by the time we got to Tennessee last year, I kind of said, well, fuck it, we're already this fucking far.
Yeah.
You might as well just like go check it out. So I went there for about 10 days and just spent time on the ground, just driving around, looking at shit, going to clubs, meeting people, you know, going to introduce myself to like producers and, you know, artists, and then like the real estate guys and all that kind of shit. The dudes that were like doing these big fucking like, you know, making all, you know, developing and shit like that. I went and met with people like that, you know, developers, and there's a thing called the Detroit Motor City Match and organizations like that that are kind of being put together by probably the banking industry to kind of, you know, infuse, you know, life back into the place. Well, when I got there, it just reminded me of like Long Beach in the early 80s.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like really just kind of shitty and rough, but there's enough cool people here to make a cool thing happen. And it's not like a cool thing hadn't happened there before.
Yeah.
I mean, fucking Motown and the auto industry and the railroad industry and the timber
and then
industry,
the punk rock scene.
Punk rock and just like the Black Panthers and social movements and just food, all kinds of shit. So it's like, huh, well, this... You know, I didn't have to really think about it that much, honestly, because I could just open a fucking history book and there it is, you know. So I thought, wow, this is really interesting because it's a, you know, it's a landmark fucking place.
It's the Motor City, man.
And so I thought, well, fuck, I mean, if I can do this in L.A., certainly I can do it here and maybe even better, you know, because I'll be less distracted. You know, I'll be able to focus more on what I'm doing, and and maybe even afford a fucking house for my wife and my kid. You know?
Yeah.
Maybe even be able to buy myself a fucking building someday here.
Yeah.
You know, maybe, you know, just all these ideas started popping in my head. I was like, so by the time I left there, I had hooked up with a real estate agent, and my wife and I had started doing the paperwork to get pre-approved for, you know, so we went with the bank and did all that shit and got all our ducks in a row. And I went through a lot of doubt, like a lot of, and still am.
Yeah.
You know, it's very kind of frightening. I'm from here.
Yeah, you're from LA, man. You've been here fucking 49 years.
I'm moving to Mars, you know, so... So, you know, but knowing guys like Dean Fertitta and other guys that I have, that friends of mine that I have from Detroit, like my whole life, I've always, there's always somebody that in my circle of friends that was from Detroit, ironically. And I've always just, it always just seemed like they weren't from Detroit. I don't know if that makes sense.
Yeah, yeah, right.
It's like, wait a minute, you're from the East Coast. Why do you talk like us? Why are you so, like, we have the same kind of jargon and lingo.
Yeah.
And the same kind of like fucked up kind of, you know, thing. And so when I went there, I kind of, you know, I went to this club called the Raven Club, and it's in the middle of like the crack zombie fucking territory.
Oh yeah. Just, the part where there's no, I drove down streets there and there was shit closed for miles, like full streets of abandoned, nothing. And just those oil, like canister, the garbage cans on fire. There's no street lights. And you're like,
steam coming.
You're like, what the fuck happened here? I mean, that is the most bizarre thing to be going through a full city and there's nothing open for 20 blocks.
Yeah, so we wound up at the Raven Club the second night that I went there. And this is like a shitty little fucking ghetto ass fried chicken and waffles at midnight, fucking soul food, and just like church style blues.
Yep.
You know, not like not like guttural stuff, not like Mississippi or Delta, but like, you know, more church style. And they were just open arms, and outside was just crack zombie fucking destructo land, but inside was like amazing. So I thought, you know what?
It's like your dad's painting, going back to that where you grew up.
This. Yeah, I think I can get along here just fine. You know,
yeah.
I can do this. So I got back and I told my wife, and she was like, you know what? Yeah, I think that's a good, I think I want to go and check it out. So I, you know, booked the trip, packed up the girls, we went out there, took about a week, had the real estate guy and booked a bunch of appointments and looked at a bunch of houses up and down the coastline, which would be like Grosse Pointe Woods, Grosse Pointe Farms, Grosse Pointe, you know, the whole fucking Grosse Pointe thing coming out of the downtown area. And that's all, that's the area, you know, the Indian Village and the, you know, all the Boston Edison and all that shit, where like there's opulent giant fucking mansions and shit, just beautiful. But right outside, looking out your back window, is a, you know, a burnt out fucking house with, you know, five people living in it.
Right.
Shit like that. And I was just like, I don't want, I can't live like that either. That's just retarded. No matter how good the deal is, I can't do that. I can't do that to them.
Yeah, yeah, right.
You know?
Right.
So who the fuck am I, you know? So we went and looked at a bunch of stuff, and my wife is all about the educational stuff for the kid and all that, and, you know, obviously. And I'm more about a good deal.
You're like, hey, fuck school, man. Yeah. I don't have to build 7,000 guitars for this one.
Well, my kid knows that I dropped out in like the ninth grade.
She's always been like,
how do you do this?
Yeah, you dropped out in the ninth grade.
You know?
I don't, why do I need to go to school? Exactly. You didn't.
Yeah, I remember having the conversation with her, walking her to school in like the second grade. She stops me and she says, Daddy, how do I not go to school like you? And I was honey.
That's so fucking funny.
That's
man.
Not how it works, honey. It's an accident.
This is
just a big accident. So so we get there and we're looking at houses and the girls are just thrilled. You know, it's a great, beautiful fucking weather and all that shit. And I'm like, cold schmo, fuck, whatever. You know, I don't know what these people are talking. It ain't cold here. So then So we get back home. We didn't find anything. We're actually kind of depressed about it because it was like, you know, you go there hoping to...
Yeah, see the magic spot.
Yeah, and nothing happens. And you're like, you get home. We're all depressed and shit. And like 2 days later, We were on a feed, like an MLS feed. So you get the updates every day of what's on the market. And our real estate agent had taken a vacation. He was down in Mexico. It's like 2 a.m. I get a text from my wife and she's like, "Hey, check this out." And I saw the text, but I didn't open it up. I went home, went to sleep, and got back the next day. And I opened up the text, and I saw it. And I called, and I hit her back. I was like, "Hey, you see this fucking house?" She's like, "Yeah, dummy. Like,
yeah.
There's a fucking plane ticket at home waiting for you. And here's go get the check. You know.
Yeah.
Go get me this fucking house."
So, wow.
So I jumped and I got on the plane and with the check, and I went there, and I just. When I arrived at I took Grand River, which is the main thoroughfare going out of Detroit from the airport. I drove that the whole way because I didn't want to get there too soon.
Yeah,
and I wanted to drive there and see.
Make sure you're making the right thing.
Well, I wanted to see what the fuck was on the way.
Yeah.
Like, okay, if I want to drive this, I want to see what we're getting into here, and it was like. There was a lot of desolation, a lot of fucking burned out shit. It's the fucking ghetto. And I'm driving and driving and driving. Finally, I get to this little neighborhood, and it's just trees. You can't really see anything but a lot of trees. And I dip into this neighborhood off of Grand River, and it completely changes.
Wow.
It's like now I'm in San Marino. All of a sudden, you know, it's lush green everywhere and beautiful houses. They weren't opulent fucking mansions, but just kind of normal looking.
Right.
Kind of like Miracle Mile area.
Oh, yeah, you know, yeah, that, yeah. Wow, that's sick.
Or like, you know, San Marino or South Pasadena.
Yeah.
That's
Highland Park. I mean, Larchmont, that kind of shit.
Yeah. And so I'm like, oh, this is cool. You know, I like this. And there's no burned out fucking nothing. It's a nice neighborhood. And it stretches for a while. So I get to where I'm getting close to our house, or, you know, where I was going to go look. And it just all of a sudden turns into like a fucking forest.
Yeah.
And there's like a giant abandoned golf course, and it's like trees and birds and shit everywhere, and just like all of a sudden it's like I'm in this enchanted fucking forest. And I round the corner and I see the house, and it's this giant stone Tudor from 1925.
Wow.
And just got all, you know, it's just like, you know, and I could see like it's a clay roof, you know, and it's the stonework was just fucking immaculate. You know? And I just parked the car and got out and sat down on the ground across the street because there's no curb. I sat on the grass and watched all the people meandering in and out of the house because it was an open house.
Yeah.
And just kind of watched and looked and just kind of started. I had to catch my breath because my heart was beating so fast.
Like, that's the one.
And I was like, holy shit.
Yeah.
Like, well, God, if you're real,
yeah,
get me this fucking house, you know.
Yeah, it's hilarious. A man who took bullets.
You're right.
You know what I mean? If you're real and you're still walking,
prove to me that you're really real and get me this fucking house. So I sat there for a minute and kind of gathered my thoughts, and I was really nervous because I'd never done nothing like that.
Yeah,
and I saw a guy walking around. Who just like looked like the guy I should talk to.
Yeah.
You know, I was like, that's the guy I should talk to. I didn't know who the fuck anybody was because my agent wasn't there. He was in Mexico on his back and, you know, under a fucking umbrella somewhere. But one of his representatives came and I wasn't even paying attention to him. And so I V-lined it to this dude, and his name is Ron Clem, and he was representing the seller.
Yeah.
I had no idea. He looked like the guy I should talk to. So I introduced myself, and he's like, "Oh, okay." And we got to chopping it up a little, and there were still people in the house. So he took me out back, and he took me way the fuck out in this field. And back of the house, there's this wall, and in the wall, it's a stone wall, or rock wall, and there's a word that's laid into the rock wall out of other stones, and in Native American dialect, it says end of the road or end of the trail. And he, you know, we got to talking about my mother's heritage and
yeah.
You know, all that stuff, and my dad and me and art and guitars and rock and roll and shit. And he's an ex-junkie, you know.
Wow.
From New York. Okay, yeah, so we get to chopping it up about all that shit, you know, and stealing cars and hookers and whatever.
Yeah.
And you know, we get to talking, and he's like, "Oh, let me show you the house." So we're talking about guitar making and all that kind of shit, and he's taking me through the house, and I'm telling him, like, you know, about my historical restoration, you know, experience, and pointing out details to him and telling him about the significance of some of the craftsman's work on the home, and some of the woodwork, and some of the leaded glass, you know, and the crystal doorknobs and the woodwork and all that shit in the house, and very familiar with all that stuff. So he was like, "Wow, man, you know a lot about this fucking house already. You don't even know about the house. Let me tell you about the house." So turns out it was commissioned by the Fords for one of their family members, and it was a country home.
Whoa, for the Ford Motor Company owners, yeah, like the Ford people. Yeah, wow.
Yeah, so they had bought it as a gift to one of their family members.
That's crazy.
And had it custom built. So he's like, "Hey, look at this." And he shows me, we have the original deed to the land.
Whoa.
From the 1836.
Whoa.
And also the original blueprints to the house.
Insane.
Yeah. And so I'm looking at these things just going, "Oh my God, nobody can." Like, and I said to him, like, "What do I got to do to get this fucking house?"
Yeah.
And he's like, "It's not up to me, you know, it's up to the owners." By the way, the owner was a lifelong musician who taught classical piano, violin, viola, and trumpet out of the house. You know, they owned the house since 1970. He just died, and he was like 92 or something like that. And so we got to talking about, you know, music and the whole thing, because he taught, you know, it was a music house, basically.
Yeah.
So by the time we got done with, you know, talking and getting acquainted and seeing the house and everything, and you know, they had a bunch of offers on the house at that point, and some really good cash offers too. And the house listed for $175,000, which is,
oh my God,
retarded.
You can't even get this fucking, yeah, you well, can't even get a garage for that, yeah, in
no,
LA.
Yeah, nothing.
Yeah.
And so he said, you know, originally they were offered $60,000 for the house, and they almost took it.
Whoa.
They didn't know how much. Nothing has sold in that neighborhood for over $75,000 in like the last 40 fucking years.
Whoa.
So he said, you know, here's the thing. They want to sell it to a family that's going to take care of it. They know that there's, you know, they know that there's investors. They know that there's people that want to flip it. They know that there's foreign fucking Chinese or, you know, Indians that want it and all that other shit, you know. And, you know, but they want it to go to a fucking family.
Right.
That's going to love it. And I just raised my hand. I was like, "What? That's us."
Yeah, yeah.
That's fucking us, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
And so, inside, of course, I didn't, you know, wasn't, yep, literal. And so I just said, "Well, you know, I can assure you that that's what we are, you know." And so I kind of, as we were leaving the tour, and the daughter showed up with her husband, and I met them, got introduced to them formally, and then we got about 5 minutes together to just kind of talk. You know, it was more like a, it was weird. It wasn't,
yeah,
it wasn't on purpose. It was just like, "Oh, hi, how are you?" and that kind of thing. And I said, "So, tell me about your dad. You know, I hear he's a musician and stuff." And so she kind of got a little teary eyed and started telling me some stories and things like that. And she's like, "What do you do?" And I told her what I did.
Yeah.
But my wife, you know, she's an artist, and about our kid, and she was in oboe at the time, and her mouth just kind of started to drop, you know.
Yeah.
And she started to get a little wet, you know, in the eye.
Yeah.
And I said, you know, I don't know if there's any criteria for the people that, or whoever you want to buy the house, or if money's the thing or whatever, but we would really cherish this home. And so I left and got back on the plane and came back here. And a couple of days later, Ron called me and said, "Hey, you know, if you're interested in the home, they'd like for you to have it. What's your highest offer?"
Wow.
And I said, "Fuck, that's amazing." So the most, our budget at the time was like $220,000. And that's fucking like every penny of cash that we had. And we had already done the prequal stuff. So there was a thing going on called the Detroit Motor City, was it the Detroit Nats or some kind of program like that that the banks were doing to kind of like, so if you bought a fucked up house, they would actually value it higher and give you a second mortgage so you could afford to refurb it and live in it. So we qualified for that even though the house didn't need any of that shit.
Yeah.
What it did was it allowed us to close the gap in what we had cash-wise to what the mortgage was.
That's amazing.
So like we had 70 grand basically to dump and we needed, you know, the rest. And so that kind of closed the gap for us and it made us, you know, be able to get the fuck
out.
That's
badass.
So
dude.
And that happened before we even got the house. We had kind of been handed this path, you know. And so, you know, they said, well, we have another offer for cash and it's $110,000 cash plus another $10,000 for all the antiques in the house. So if you can match the 10 grand cash on top of the 220, it's yours.
Jeez.
I was like, what? So I like put the phone on pause and I said, honey, do we have 10 grand? She was like, yeah, we got 10 grand. I was like,
yeah.
We'll take it, you know.
Yeah, done deal.
Where do I deliver this box of money to, you know?
Yeah.
And so so we went out and closed the deal and
that's
and
badass.
Had dinner and the funny thing, the night that we closed on the house, we all went out there to do the thing and walk it and, you know, hang out with the family. And that was the first time that, you know, my wife and daughter had been out there to see the house
yeah.
and to meet the family. And we closed the deal, went out to dinner. We were going to go to this Italian restaurant. Instead, we wound up going to Mexican town, this little Mexican fucking restaurant. We just walked in randomly, and Jack White and Dean Fertitta were there having dinner with their families.
That's a sign.
Yeah, so I walked up to Dean, and he was like facing
me. That's a fucking sign.
He wasn't facing us, and I tapped him on the shoulder. I was like, hey, man, what's up? He was like, what? What are you doing here?
That is incredible, man. That's totally a sign,
yeah.
right?
So, you know, met Jack and all that stuff, and we just had a nice quiet dinner but that's when I really, and my wife and I were like really like, okay, you know, this is we're fucking a million miles away from home.
You
know nobody.
Yeah, fuck it, man.
You know, but
you know what I mean?
But
that's the genius of, that's why I love this show, Handmade.
Yeah.
You know, these episodes I do, because it, you know, I was at the post office yesterday and I was like, this is an interesting story. I sell t-shirts, you know, and I do it all myself, but, you know, like fan shirts right there, shirts for my comedy. And as I hand wrote every goddamn label, I was sitting there yesterday going, fuck, man, 100 of these, you know, handwriting the label. I got to get a printer and just do it. But I, you know, I just like, ah, fuck it. I don't want to pay for that, you know. So I hand wrote them all and I was complaining to myself. You know, just like, this is fucking crazy doing this, man. And I walked to the post office. It's in this drugstore post office slash right here up the street. And I put them up and the girls, I go, how's it going today? And she's like, oh, man, I fucking just hate my job. And I hate this place. And, you know, and I realized as she was spewing her shit to me, I was thinking, man, these labels are for me. This comedy I'm doing, everything I'm doing, and it hit me right in the face. I was like, I'm so fucking happy. This girl is just spewing garbage at me. She's miserable in some shit job, and she won't even change it. You know what I mean? So it's inspiring to have dudes like you or people out there that are, you know, taking chances and living outside the box.
Yeah, I mean, when it all started being real and going down, I the doubt hit me. You know, then all the fear set in and all the anxieties and all the like what ifs and how come, like all the shit was just like, you know, like what the fuck am I doing, like this is crazy, you know. And all along, you know, having friends and comrades and colleagues and you know, buddies just going, dude, how and why, you know, constantly like, why Detroit? How are you doing this, you know?
Yeah.
And even there, it's like, why here? Like, what are you fucking crazy? You're in the land of, like, glitter and fucking fake titties and sunsets and shit.
And rock and roll, you know, where people have extra cash.
Yeah, it's like, what are you, why, no, you know, what are you doing here? It's like, I don't know. I don't need to know, really. Yeah, you know, it's like the evidence to me.
Dude, in your shop building guitars, you're not even going to know where the fuck you are.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It ain't going to matter. I mean, really, I mean, I look at it like I serve the guitars, my wife and my kid.
Yeah.
And the artists and clients that I'm so fucking blessed and lucky to have.
Totally.
You know, and that's it.
Well, you make good shit, so, you know. Thanks for doing the show, dude.
Are you kidding?
I can't thank you enough for being it. And check out his website, EchoParkAmplifiers.com and EchoParkGuitars.com. And what's the waiting list right now?
Depends. You know, it can be anywhere from 6 months to a year and a half. Depending on what it is or who it is and that kind of thing.
Yeah,
you know, There's a lot of stuff to kind of filter.
And you got an Instagram.
Yeah.
Check that out, Echopark Guitars.
Uh-huh.
And I'm looking forward to doing some comedy out there and then coming and seeing you, man.
Oh, dude, yeah.
You got to update your site here. It says Los Angeles, California.
That's what I'm going to... Tomorrow's the day that we're changing everything, so...
That's great, dude.
I'm here until the 19th, and then I go back for the rest of our lives, so...
Well, thank you so much, man, for doing the show.
I'm fucking so stoked that I could do it.
Kick ass, dude. Yeah. All right, guys. Thanks for tuning in to another episode of Handmade. Let there be talk, and check out his Instagram. You're going to love his stuff, and you've definitely heard it on all kinds of music you love if you listen to his podcast, from Queens of the Stone Age and Eagles of Death Metal and Aerosmith, all that. Thank you, guys. See ya. Candles lit.